there's a saying that says that if what goed begin is half gewin. What when you begin well, you are halfway there. Is that so? Okay. His good half is that he started in Bloemfontein, like many other good people.
So, okay, there we go. Just say God had started humility early in my life in Bloem.
Yeah. We were born humble there. Tell us a little bit, Hannes, just your whole journey. You guys are in the pharmaceutical industry, and you went to school in Bloemfontein. Just tell us a little bit, the first couple of minutes of your journey, where it started, where things started, and how your path started off.
Cool. Okay, born and bred in Bloemfontein. I grew up in a very loving family and a Christian family, very blessed to be in a Christian family. And especially nowadays, if you see what happens in the world out there, only late in your life do you realize how fortunate you really were. And I went to school in Bloemfontein. I was called to do my conscription in the army in 1990. I thought I'd be very clever, be the first group to do 1 year, because it's sure to go back to 2 years after that, only for the conscription to be cancelled afterwards. And then studied in Bloemfontein, started studying medicine, and at the end of my third year, pharmacology was my next level of humility. And pharmacology was a real challenge to me, but after finishing my third year, I realized that wasn't God's call for me. I'd always had this thing in my deep inner being that I should be in business. I remember my mom sending me back to school the one day, very angrily, because I picked up a porcupine, a porcupine needle, and went to school, and Yaku Els, I'll never forget his name, he had the most awesome pocket knife set. It came in a leather holder that you could zip closed. And I showed him this porcupine needle. And I convinced him that this was so awesome that he insisted to give me his pocket knife. Went home very proud of my achievement, only to let my mom tell me they're going to lock me up. I must take it back the next day. And I took it back the next day, and he refused to give it back to me because he wanted to hold on to that porcupine needle. business was in deep entrenched in my being from a very young age.
You saw that quickly. That's a typical Bloemfontein trick also that we could do. Tell me a little bit, ending your medical studies after 3 years. Did that feel like a bit of a failure? I mean, you were supposed to become a doctor. I mean, it's a very respected profession to follow. And all of a sudden, after 3 years, this is not what you're going to do. You want to go into business. Do people look funny at you? How did God use that in your journey? I mean, we know God is in control of everything. And now in hindsight, we can see, and we're going to get to that whole story. How did God use that?
I was quite involved at university as well, especially within the hostel committees and the student council, etc. And we just started a medical hostel as well. And I was in one of the leadership roles there. And the next year, I dropped out to finish my bachelor's of science. And I mean that makes you that does add to your at that point in time, especially if you're 21, 22 years old. I mean, life, it's not about what life is; it's about what you're going to make life. And or make of the world. And I think God really used that to just show me that he's got a plan and that I must just stick to that. And just in that year, he gave me the opportunity to be involved in things that were really significant to me and that still is significant to me today. And the good friends I had at university, the medical students, I'm still good friends with them. I made a lot of other friends, and I got involved in a couple of projects which till today is still very close to my heart. So God really used that to put me on the right path. And at the end of the day, just to make you realize that you've got plans, but I shared with Marna beforehand, when I was 11 years old, the 1983 translation of the Afrikaans Bible just came out. And when that Christmas, my grandfather gave each of us a Bible as a Christmas gift. And in front of mine, he had Psalm 37, verse 5, which just said, yeah, basically comes down to leave it, yeah, commit your life to the Lord, follow him, and he will do it. And yeah, that just once again proved that to be true. Because yeah, if you commit your way to the Lord, he will make sure that it works out for the better.
Hannes, quickly tell us your first job, and how did you end up in where you are today? Just that professional journey a little bit.
I started off, having nearly flunked pharmacology. I started in the pharmaceutical industry. God does have a sense of humor. And I was involved in the pharma industry, started in the sales department. It went very well, moved into marketing. And at age 28, I was, the youngest marketing manager the company had ever had. So really focused on my career, very, very driven on climbing the corporate ladder as you are at that stage of your life. And then I got to a point where I realized that if I keep on with this, it was the second weekend in July that year, and I realized at that moment, I was still single simply because I didn't have time to meet someone, and I realized that was the fifth weekend that year that I'd been home. So, God just put in my heart then that it's time to settle down. I've learned a lot, but, he didn't have the plan for me to burn out never, and especially not at age 28. And I then started discussing with a couple of colleagues. We uncovered a real need within the industry to assist medical specialists with specific components of their practice. And, through the grace of God in 2002, a couple of months after that, after realizing that, we started Spacenet, which is a business I'm still involved in today. And that's also been a 14-year journey up to now.
And then typically how God works, he gives you this great promise. You take a massive step of faith, start a new company, and everything works out fantastically.
Yes, it's Facebook is real. That is life.
Tell us about that first while, and just maybe about that conflict. Tell us a little about God's promise, and then what happened then.
Okay, we started Spacenet, bright-eyed, bushy-tailed. We are going to change the world, of course. And in August the next year, there was a business conference at Brooklyn campus. I was actually quite ill then. I had bronchitis or pneumonia or whatever. I can't remember. And the third day of the conference, I struggled through the first day. I was in bed the second. But the third day, I just really felt a stirring that I had to be there. I went there. I was still had fever. My wife couldn't understand what I was thinking. And Pastor Johan Stein was doing a session. Him and Martinez Stefan, who's at Doxadeo. And they said that if you want a prophecy, please come to the front. So I was there, and I stood in front of Johan, and Johan said that he really experienced that God has called me to be a king in the business world, and that I've been called to make a great difference in the business environment. And then he pushed me down to my knees, and he stood next to me, and he says, "But God says that I must know it's because of his power. It's not my power, and that I must remain on my knees, because while I'm there, God will bless what I'm doing." And we each have our factory faults, and I know God knows us, he made us. And it was necessary for me to hear that. And that was all recorded and written up and sent to me. So that's a reference that I still have till today, which is critical. And that word was confirmed by two other friends and mentors within the within my faith walk, within the next couple of months after that. And then, of course, 3 months after that happened, the money dried up. And we went through a point where 11 months, we had appointed staff, we had vendors. For 11 months, we were in a position where I had this word of God in my life, and we were in a position where we were five business partners at that point in time. After vendors and salaries were paid, there was 15,000 rand left to divide between the five of us. Now, 15,000 rand a month sounds great, but 15,000 rand every 6 months doesn't sound so great. And then end of the month, we'd sit and say, "Well, the bank has phoned me three times for about the car and twice about my bond, And then you're the fortunate winner, you get it this month. So that was a time you didn't take an unknown number, because you knew it was going to be the bank or the credit card company or West Bank wanting to take back the vehicle.
So Anas, here you sit 8 months, 9 months down the line, five very clever guys, and you've got a business with a great profit of 15,000 rand a month divided between all five of you. But you have a word of God. Let's pause the story there for 1 minute. So what we'd like you to do, around your table, how long do you hold on to God's promise in the face of not making profit, looking at just newlywed, was the first one on her way, or not yet, newlywed, with this great plan, you tell your wife you're going to build this fantastic business, and every month she's like, where's the money? And now we think it's coming someday. What do you do in that situation? What do you think they were supposed to do? How were they supposed to handle it? Maybe you've been in your business in that critical point where you think basically all we've got is a word from God and a structure which is not turning any profit really. Is this going to work or not? It's 9 months down the line, which is a critical phase in a new business. Is it going to make it or not? Could you quickly discuss, what do you think you would have done? What do you think they were supposed to do? It's going to be a short discussion. We're going to have two or three of those during our session. Tell us quickly, Anas, how did that end? How did that story, what did you guys do 9 months down the line? What did you do?
I prayed a lot. I think that really causes a moment where you really doubt if you heard God correctly. Because just three, four months before that, I was so sure that SpaceNet was going to be the thing that God had planned for me. So we spent a lot of time in prayer, spoke with a lot of people. From a business perspective, we do everything we can and then wait. Because at that point in time, you've literally done everything you can do, and you're waiting for a phone call, and it's not happening. So we had lots of time to think and speak amongst our partners. I think at one stage, all of our CVs were out in the market because we started thinking, no, this thing's not going to work. And not one of us even had an interview, and we were overqualified for every position. So we, after a point, we saw, no, this really is God's plan. Yeah, so we literally stuck it out. And but the fact that, you know, it took us about 3-4 months to just get to that truth, and then also realize that we're going through something because we all know the story that, you know, there is a time of birth. It takes a human 9 months to give birth. The gestation period of a buffalo is 343 days. So the bigger it is, the longer the gestation period, and how the longer God starts forming you. And we started realizing that, but it's one thing to realize that, and then your wife has to go to the shop and buy the day-old bread rolls because it's half price. So it was a tough time, but we realized that it was time to stick it out. So we had to be more creative in what we wanted to do commercially. And after 2 years in, we started seeing the light. We could start paying ourselves a salary. And 3 years in, we got to a point where we could start looking at paying back the salaries that we'd missed. So then we started taking the unknown numbers again. But I'm making light of it now, but the key thing of that is we so often have things that God has planned for us. And when it becomes tough, we think, no, we'll tough it out. And then we think we have toughed it out, but God knows we haven't yet. And the power of perseverance, sorry, I didn't mean to do that so loud into the mic, but the power of perseverance, if you know that you are where God has placed you to be, is very valuable. But that's the core thing. You must know that you are where God placed you to be.
I don't want to jump our story, but today it's 14 years later. SpaceNet is on the verge of changing history in the pharmaceutical industry with certain products. You are going to, I think that some of the stuff you guys are working on with the near future is literally revolutionizing the industry worldwide. Is going to make lives better across the world and a lot of stuff. So I'm not wanting to jump that, but just to see how that story has escalated to where we are today and how that's grown. And and you sometimes have to stick it out. I think of so many business people and leaders you speak to all can relate to that season where you had to really just hold on to that word of God. Somebody once said to us, sometimes God gives you that prophecy because he knows there's going to come a time where that's the only thing you have to hold on to. And you need to hold on to that. So thank you. That really encourages. I trust that encouraged a lot of you as well right there. Tell us a little bit. In the same time you started, or soon after that, you started another company called Impact RX. And tell us a little bit about that journey on us.
We started a division in SpaceNet that looked at statistical analysis and utilizing information we could access in the market and then restructure that and sell it to the pharmaceutical manufacturers. About a year in with that product, we were in the GP environment, that was that type of product was also available. But the company who did that actually went bankrupt. So they then approached us and said, guys, don't you want to do what you do for the medical specialists, because we were very niche. Don't you want to do that for the rest of the market, which we thought was a fantastic opportunity. It was a private a private discussion, and eventually we were formally approached by one of the big hospital groups who had associated with these guys to just give them some structure to actually go down that route. They asked us to put in to submit the tender to do the work, and we had an idea with regards to what they wanted to generate, but we knew we knew that we really felt that it was something that would be significant in our lives going forward. So we actually, from the word go, committed to double what we knew they required to give that back to them, because firstly we wanted the business, but secondly we realized that we were going to invest. We knew how to stick it out through tough times now. But we knew there was going to be an investment cycle, but that's fine because long-term this would be good. So the people we'd been working with on this project in SpaceNet, we then thought, well, cool, we know where to access the information required. We know all of these things. So it's literally just, let's sign the contract. Let's go to our current suppliers, and we can quickly sort this out and probably... being very, very bullish, 15 days later we'll have a product in the market, only to knock on that door and for them to say, well, you know what, we like working with you, but we're not interested in being involved in a wider environment with the GP, groups, etc. So there we were with a contract and nothing to do with it. And we put down a very bullish timeline of 15 days. So, yeah, once again, back on the knees. And we just prayed on it. And one of the guys we partnered with to supply the IT then said, look, he's been trying to get something going with a guy who's in the pharmacy software environment, set up a meeting, and lo and behold, 15 days down the line, we actually had our first data available, and we started supplying the way that we were supposed to be supplying. The business went well. And then, of course, just as we got into the point where we were about to start making profit, the one group came to us and said, no, look, they've reviewed this and they've spoken to other people. It's always other people. You never know who the other people are, but they've spoken to the other people. And the other people have said that they'll actually pay them more than what we were paying them, which is now, of course, double what they originally required. And they wanted more now because they feel they're key to this whole process and very important. And we then sat and said, but guys, I mean, really, we've got a signed agreement. We've just invested a year in this project. We're about to start breaking even, not making profit, breaking even. Now suddenly you want more. Long story short, we then started investigating from a legal perspective, started calling their bluff on certain things that they said that they actually had. And those are really moments where God, the Holy Spirit was very active in certain meetings, because we'd walk in there 29, 30 years old, and you think you're old and mature then, but yeah, when you're 44, you know you weren't then, and when you're 64, you know you weren't mature when you were 44. So looking back, I realized we were really, really fresh in the game, and we sat there negotiating with lawyers who did this for a life for one of the big hospital groups. And God just said, well, stick it out. We we just told him, we just told him that we were going to honor our side. It was their calling. They were going to honor their side. If they wanted to go elsewhere, they were welcome to, but we weren't going to stop doing what we are doing. We're doing at that point in time, because what we were doing, we actually didn't need them to do it. We thought that would be the nice play to go that route. And that sometimes is difficult, because you get into an agreement with someone because of the need that they have. And then down the line, they start abusing you. You know that whatever you do, you are doing according to the rules and the rules of the agreement. And also morally, we knew we were doing the right thing. And we got to a point where we just said, well, guys, you know what? If you want to go, that's fine, go. But know that we are going to continue doing what we are doing, because we don't need you to do that. And they then decided to go their separate ways. I still remember the discussion that I had with one guy. We were, at that point in time, our agreement was that 30% of revenue would go to them, not profit, but revenue, which was a big sum. And he said, no, these other guys promised them 70%. And I still had a long discussion with the one guy once and said, just remember that you're generating more income now than you have ever out of this source of income, but 70% of nothing is still nothing. And he said, no, he knows, but they're going to take the risk. And a couple of months in after they did that, we were still going along. Their stuff then didn't work out. So they started started playing the dirty game, started defaming us in the market. And we were really 100% within the law, within the guidelines of the industry, etc. And we got to a point where we realized, look, we either got to ignore them or we got to take this thing head on. We decided to actually deliver a legal letter on the MD of that company to ask them to desist of the defaming behavior within the market. And then the next morning I got a phone call. My colleague was in the office early, and he said, no, he thinks it's best if I come in. And I said, well, I'm on my way. What's this about? He says, no, he really thinks it's best if I just come into the office now. So I walk into the office to see an email with a draft article from one of the sub-editors of the report, basically painting us as the most unethical organization ever within the history of South Africa, stealing money, stealing information. And that was one of those cold water in the in the face moments. And so behind our back, these guys were not just spreading lies, but they then decided that they wanted to take us out to the knees and go to the press.
Well, the question is, should we quickly maybe break and ask yourselves around your tables again? So it's a Friday morning, Thursday. It was Thursday.
Thursday, the deadline for feedback to the report was 4 o'clock on Friday afternoon.
Then the paper would go to press, and with this whole article, front page article in report of telling everybody how bad this company is, but all the facts are not what you agree with. What do you do in a situation like that?
Okay, run is not an option.
You want to quickly discuss it. What do you do? It's Thursday morning. Friday, the newspaper is going to be printed. Your company is going to be on the front page of the report with all the negative stuff for the whole country to see.
What I would have done, I would presume that your service delivery is in a very specific market segment to a specific audience. It's not like you're selling Rice Krispies to the whole country, so your name is that popular. Or important. So what I would have done is I would have responded to report, and I would tell them, listen, if you go ahead and publish this article, we'll probably get a legal opinion and get back to you, because there's a couple of things we don't agree with. And then I would have drafted a letter to my clients, which obviously you know very well, and I would tell them, listen, there's this thing coming out, and I mean, we assure you of our proper conduct, our books are open, come and have a look. You're welcome to audit us at any time.
I do kind of believe someone once told me, within an environment where you always, where people always look up to you, makes it difficult if you're running the company, for instance, you never have the benefit of context for the decisions that you make. So people inevitably look at what the decisions were that you made, and they make up their mind as to whether it was a bad decision or a good decision. Either way, whether it was good or bad, you don't have the benefit of context. And you have this drive just to explain your side of the story. So I once spoke to a person that said, the blessings of Abraham is yes and amen in Jesus Christ. And that is available to you. So God said to Abraham, I will make your name great. And he says, you never have to defend your name. That's my job. So I would remind myself of that promise with a looming deadline and an article, and then obviously trying to create space where you actually speak out for what you stand and what you do. So you have the crisis communications kick in and all of that, but the leader needs to step up with the context that you do not have the privilege of giving context for who you are and what you do. And remind yourself that God will make your name great and that your name is protected by promise, your reputation, your identity in Him.
So those are two interesting answers. One from the farmer, which says, take a legal, warn them legally. One from a legal advisor that says, trust God. So that's, don't go legal. So honest, what did you do? What did you do?
Well, firstly, I must honor my wife in her absence, Liesl, because yeah, the next thing I knew, we had people from the whole country telling us they're praying for us. So,
but then the wisest thing is listen to your wife.
Yes.
So that's basically what you say.
Fortunately, looking back, we really struggled with the question if we should have sent out that legal letter on the Wednesday. And thank God we did, because we felt released that morning to do that, because that was the first thing that we could do when we got this, that we sent that letter to the journalist. He reviewed it, and then I called him, and I said to him, look, this is the context, this is what's going on, and I painted our side of the story, because if we didn't say anything, he would have just said no comment from Impact RX. And at the same time, we started the PR engine. My sister-in-law and one of my best friends is in PR. So by the Friday afternoon at 5 o'clock, everyone in the industry, all our clients knew that something was going to come out and that it was going to be defaming. But the challenge we had and the big stress points was in the original article, they had named of our clients. And those are public companies. And the last thing you want to do is that someone spreading falsehoods about you and your company, blue chip company, is damaged by that, because then you kind of, you're kind of done in the market if you cause damage to your clients.
So the Sunday report comes out. You didn't sleep for two nights.
That's correct. I lost 3 kilograms. I found 5 afterwards.
Okay. What did the article say? From front page?
From front page, it went to the page 2 top corner of the business report, and it actually painted us as the ethical player in the business and exposed the guys who initiated the article as guys who were doing what they're not supposed to be doing. So I mean, once again, that just once again proved God's as Leon said now.
Yeah.
And really, at the end of the day, it just established our faith once again, because no matter what's thrown at you, if you're doing what you're doing according to God's will and according to God's ways, then the papers can come. It's fine, because you're clear.
So God changed that thing around. Let's move to the next phase. The next phase, let's just call it the success test. Next phase, the business is growing into great success, great profitability. It's growing. It's just fantastic season. Is everything rosy now? What happened then?
course it is. Money makes everything better. Well, we'll be you'll be the judge of that soon. I think mostly the biggest test of character is not survival, but it's success. I'm talking about all the ups and downs, but in general, it really was an up and up and up. Being in business, that's what I was born for. But we then got to a point where we were five partners, and two of them then started drifting. The money was good. We started appointing good people, so we had some free time. We could actually get home while the sun was still out and spend some time with family. The one partner who wasn't a Christian then started drifting, and he was looking for meaning and this and that and whatever. Really demotivated, and got to a point where he said, "Guys, you know what? This is not. Yeah, I don't know what I want for life, but I think I've got some money now, so I'm gonna leave you." Which it made it difficult because financially we were doing well, but now suddenly we had to evaluate the business and buy out our partner. So that put us back a bit financially, but you're investing in your business, so that was fine. And then one of my best friends, who was another partner, unfortunately got involved in abusive behavior. So he fell victim to alcohol and use of drugs, etc. And morally went in a very bad way. And it was a difficult time because it wasn't just my colleague, it was one of my best friends, and we went through a period where I thought the best thing I could do for him was to help him and try and cover up for him, and ended up doing his work, etc., only for that to get to a boiling point at some stage where there was great conflict. I don't want to go into too much of that now, but there was great conflict, and we then he then decided to part ways. Then once again, we had to buy him out, but thank God everything was in place for us to be able to do that.
So that was a leadership test, success test. I think that's something we often experience in life. There's different tests and different phases. And during that first phase of startup, suffering, holding on to God's promise, certain tests. But when success and fame, or whatever you want to call it, comes to you, different levels of tests, which tests your character from a different angle again. Impact Rx grows, becomes successful, becomes a, in words that I think the IMS guys used, there was a company then that wanted to acquire Impact Rx, and in their words they said Impact Rx is a small stone in their shoe.
A very sharp pebble in his shoe.
A very sharp pebble, very irritating. Very small company, busy taking major clients from a massive multinational pharmaceutical company, and they were your only competition in the market, and your biggest competition now wants to buy you, which leads to a due diligence. Tell us about that. How do you handle that?
Yeah, that was a very interesting time. It was actually they'd approached us twice before. The first time we weren't ready, so we said, well, we don't think it's the time. The second time we were actually interested, but unfortunately the regional manager at that point in time, we caught him in lies twice within the first 2 months and realized we didn't want to walk the way with him. So with that background, then one of the big bosses from Europe phones, and he says now he wants to have dinner. So we sat down, actually had quite a good rapport with him, and then he told us we were a very sharp pebble in his shoe. He's a 21 billion market cap company on the New York Stock Exchange. We're a couple of Bursians from Centurion who, by the grace of God, have been able to outwit them. And as Manu then said, we discussed amongst the partners at that point in time and then said, okay, well, the business is geared in such a fashion that we can actually look at selling it. But now they want to know everything about us. They are only opposition. They've got deep pockets that if we expose the secret source, we expose ourselves to them, and they, whatever the integrity of sorts.
I'm not sure if it's such a simple question. So what basically happens is your main competition says, we want to do due diligence on you, which means we want to see everything of you, to decide if we want to buy you. What do you do? Is it a yes or no answer around the tables quickly? No. The answer is a no. Let's just buy the show of hands. How many think you can you go easily down that route? We would go and say, yes, yeah, do a due diligence, look at everything, look at our financials, our strategy, everything. Who would go no? Who would go say, shh. Okay, so if we had a vote, you shouldn't have done it. But you did.
Oh my goodness.
Okay, so what did you do?
We prayed.
Again. I mean, you've prayed three times now already. It's like
lost another 4 kilograms.
Is it three times or is it nonstop? Okay, so tell us about that.
No, that was a very tough decision, but we got to a point where we could, we tried to get to a point where we felt some level of comfort, but we also at that point in time realized that we took a step back from ourselves and just looked at the market and looked at the dynamics and the environment at that point in time, as well as the people we had employed, because, I mean, this is a big decision. Everyone who worked for us at that point in time, I'd signed their letter of appointment. So I took responsibility for them because I said I would. And looking at all of that, we initially said, well, it's too great a risk. We're not interested. But meditating on it got to a point where we realized that if we wanted to provide for our people going forward, if we wanted to provide them opportunity to grow, if we wanted to provide them opportunities to grow internationally, it did make sense. But on top of that, looking at the dynamics of the South African pharmaceutical space at that point in time, as well as the challenges, the value that they brought to the market and the value that we brought to the market, we saw the real synergies. So through godly wisdom, we got to a point and I knew it was God because I also said no initially. It's like moving from Stellenbosch to Pretoria. and just got to a point where we realized, look, we need to take the next step. But we needed to be very, very clear about our boundaries. They appointed Ernst & Young to do the financial due diligence and Edward Nathan Sonnenberg to do the legal due diligence. So I was fortunate to spend time in their offices and not pay for it. But I spent a lot of time there. And I mean, we had a legal firm, two partners and a couple of article clerks. And our auditors was a group of two. So we had to approach this beast. And it was quite a joke. The guy who initiated the discussions was Alan Wong. It's a Chinese guy who worked for IMS. And we had the joke that we said, no, we want Alan to lie on the table because we need a Chinese wall.
All of China. Okay.
But, we sign agreements with them to, but an agreement is only always worth a paper that is written on. But we found a level of comfort. And then without exposing client names and supplier names, they could evaluate all the financials, contracts, etc. And then after long negotiations, we got to a point where we realized that what they were putting on the table, that makes sense.
Hannes, we've got 5 to 10 minutes left. So the deal went through. You got bags full of money. Did you honor the people? How did you share the spoils also with your people?
That's quite important because amongst the partners, we had another company involved as well, and the guys weren't Christians, but we said, look, guys, if we do this, before we even started talking money, we wanted to give X percentage of what we generated back to our people because we wouldn't have been where we were if it wasn't for them. So we got agreement on that, and part of the discussion and part of the agreement was at the end of the day that a proper portion of the money that we generated through the sale we gave back to our staff to empower them as well. And it's a year and a half down the line. They've integrated into the organization. God's grace was really great because IMS actually came to us and said that they wanted to retain the Impact Rx name. So this is one of very few countries where it's Impact Rx and IMS company. So he gave us legacy and significance in that way, and our people are now in charge of that organization. They're leading the way. Of course, it's people. There's always challenges, but the fact remains that the way of doing things that we could instill in them is now being pushed throughout that organization.
I think just shining a little bit of light on that process, I've had the privilege of working a little bit with the company and getting to meet everybody. And the one piece of feedback we got from everybody was that IMS Health, which is a massive company, says, well, where we come from, it was terrible. And what we acquired is fantastic. These guys are brilliant. Their leadership is great. It all boils down to the level of leadership that you guys have raised and the ethics that you've, the principles they've built in and the family coherence that they managed to establish, the culture that they managed to establish, which is actually just a great, can I say, a bemoediging for you. So well done on that. We'll have to finish off now. Unfortunately, the clock just keeps running and there's so many things. Just tell us currently, where's God with you guys? Let me just say this. I think the challenge for you in the story you just told is when it doesn't make sense, almost the first answer, like we all said, is don't show them, don't sell, don't this. But there are seasons in God's timing. And it's becoming aware of sometimes something where you realize there are bigger factors at play. It's actually God that is behind the scenes moving something along because there are greater things. And today we see that. I mean, share with us a little bit, where have you guys moved towards now? What are the impact you're seeing, the legacy that's lying ahead of you? And that you had to let go of something, and I think you did it very well. And now there's greater things, and it's a godly season. Hannes, where are you at?
Thanks, Martin. Yes, the sale was handled, and then I reintroduced myself into Spacenet and the organizations that we had established during that time. And we're really blessed that we then had, now you sit with money where you had a business. And now you need to manage the money so you get the same return that you did in the business. Otherwise, you did a very bad deal. So we went back and forth and then eventually decided that we were going to reinvest back into our businesses. So Spacenet has always been a services company that looked after medical specialists and the way they do business and assisting them in that. But we were now able to actually change that around, take all the information and the knowledge we had in there and become a healthcare systems company and supply systems and IT solutions to not only doctors and GPs and specialists and pharmacies, but also to administrators and governments. And yeah, we joke around the office and say, we're on the cusp of being an overnight success after only 14 years. But we're busy with a lot of things. We've had the privilege of being called into Indonesia to be involved with the biggest medical insurance company in the world. We're in final discussions with them regarding structure of what and scoping of a solution they're looking for, and that really is godly because there's no way, if you look at it from any other perspective, that a small company in Centurion would be approached by an organization with 150 million lives that they cover. We're involved in the Philippines with some bringing solutions there, and also in America. And I was in America in March, and you get involved in systems and processes and IT and business and finance and claims and billing and all these things. And you sometimes, just for a couple of minutes, forget the real reason why you're there. And we went to see the Nevada Children's Hospital in Las Vegas because they're struggling with some processes and systems. And, yeah, walking through there, there are there kids with cancer sitting there. And insurance companies are blocking them. They can't get the treatment they're supposed to get. And, yeah, when I react like this, I know that it's God's plan. So we are busy building solutions to actually help those people that can't help themselves.
Hannes, in conclusion, you guys are medical entrepreneurs. You come up with fantastic stuff. The term changing the world, influencing the world, saving the world, healing the world is becoming a reality in your businesses. Would you share just the EKG thumb machine thingy that you've created just to show people how you literally are saving lives and saving people's lives. Just that as a conclusion, then we'll finish there. Is that okay, Ruan? Is that all right?
We'll
take one or two questions maybe then.
Okay. Two of my colleagues were in Singapore in August of last year, and it was the HIMSS conference, the Healthcare Information Management Systems Society conference of Asia Pacific. Bumped into a couple of bright guys there. They actually won the award for innovation of the year, and they beat guys like Philips and Siemens and Samsung's to it. And they've developed a mobile health application, which it's actually a platform, but they built an ECG. It's this big. It looks like a memory stick. It's the world's smallest ECG. You put your two fingers on it, and within 30 seconds, it not only gives you an ECG, but it gives you a diagnosis as well. And it's just, yeah, that's just one of the things that it does, but it's really about it's taking medicine to the new level, because it learns your physiology through wearables and whatever whatever you use to access, and it compares you to you. So it doesn't compare you to the bunch of us. So if our average blood pressure is supposed to be 120 over 80, you might be 113 over 72. So it's revolutionary and really disruptive in the sense that the guy who's heading it up, MIT master's degree in engineering, and he sits with data scientists, PhDs, etc. And we were able then, because of the ImpactRx sale, to invest in that company, get a sizable chunk so that we could have influence. And we're strong commercially and they're not. So, I mean, you sometimes meet someone, you've got very few opportunities in your life that you meet someone and you know this person's going to go a very, very long way. And he's a Hindu, but he's become my brother. We've spent time together. And I have a privilege of actually speaking into his life and building a relationship with him. Having a small role to play in the impact he's going to have one day.
Hannes, thank you very much, you guys. And all the best for those, all the new products, and literally saving, trust, thousands and millions of lives in the future. Let's take one or two questions quickly. Hannes, share with us your favorite scripture. Just again, what is holding this whole journey for you? Maybe what you just shared with me, the scripture, I think you did mention maybe quickly in the beginning, but let's just repeat that scripture. I think that's something you hold on to.
Yeah, it's Psalm 35, verse 7. Commit your way to the Lord, trust in Him, and He will do it. And yeah, I think that's something my granddad, when he didn't know I was going to be a businessman one day, wrote in a Bible that he gave to me when I was 11 years old. So yeah, I think that says something to the ability we all have to create legacy and significance to our children and our children's children. And another thought with regard to life work leadership. Yeah. I did life work last year for the first time. I've probably learned more this year, my second time around. But I mean, these negotiations, all of this happened exactly at the time that we started life work leadership. So now, you're in negotiations with these guys. You don't know what tricks they're going to pull out. And you go on a two-day retreat to start something that you didn't fully understand what it was about. But I must say, just looking back, every session of Life Work last year, there was a crisis. There was a crisis either on the way to the session or the day of or the day before. And every time, God just once again showed, I actually said to Philip in the break, that He really honors the fact that we take time from our normal routine to just sit and listen and absorb and hear what God's will is for our lives and what God's way is that He wants us to walk. And so I just want to thank Ruan and the team, because last year it really, really, that was a saving grace for me, even though I thought at some stage it's going to be a big mountain for me. It ended up being a massive, massive blessing. Thank you.
And so we start seeing God's hand and God's journey, how God walks with us. And I think we start getting the privilege of looking back on a journey and start seeing the footprints of God all over 14 years of this business. And having faith of what God will do in the future. So maybe if your business is at that stage, I'm not sure which phase of development or phase of faith you are in, what you have to trust God for next. But I think the one thing we can say, listening to your story, is that God is faithful. And God has a plan. Hold on to that plan by faith and see God's faithfulness, His absolute faithfulness in everything we do. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you just for Hannes' story, and we honor you for the calling you have on his life, the life of his colleagues, and the awareness that they have as directors, Lord, of your calling in this world. We pray for them for open doors, Lord, across the world to touch physically sick people, to touch nations, Lord, that struggles with access to medical health. One of the biggest challenges of this planet is access to medical health. We pray for them, Lord, for wisdom and guidance and solutions, and just grant them heavenly wisdom. And may you open supernatural doors and just roads to finances, to finance also these new projects that they have in different countries. And Lord, may we look back in another couple of years from now and see that they've literally impacted nations with what you have done in them and through them to touch a sick and a dying world. We pray for them and we bless them today in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.